Hey everybody, it's Jeff Lafferty, Artcast 226. Got Jay Ferguson, me, Jeff Lafferty, Peter Palmiotti, and also Brody Williams. How's it go? How are you guys doing?
Doing good. How are you doing?
I'm good.
Doing good.
That's awesome. Stop the recording. So, everybody's silent.
So, how was everyone's weekend?
It was okay. It's just like, I guess it was productive, but it's like, all I did was like make prints and shit for the stupid con. I feel like I didn't get anything done, you know what I mean?
Yeah, but it's going to make you money next week, right?
Yeah, I guess so. Hopefully.
What did you do this weekend, Peter?
Well, as what I was talking about earlier, found out what we have is bed bugs, and was dealing with that. And bed bugs are like 100 times better than what we thought was, you know, a skin parasite of some sort. So it would be a lot easier to deal with.
Well, that's not good, but it's like, at least you don't have the other thing, right?
Yeah. I mean, to me, it's like 100 times better, because, you know.
Yeah.
They're bugs we could track down and get the, you know, the eggs and them and just kill them all off.
Yeah. Oh, that's good.
Yeah.
How do you get rid of those things anyway?
Well, it's, you know, anything, clothes or fabric, you stick in a washing machine, the heat gets rid of them. You know, you put, we've been pouring down some, like, white powder that is very fine, like, glass shards.
Yeah.
And basically, if they eat it, they, you know, cuts them up inside, you know, but it's not dangerous to people or animals. So
yeah.
We could even put it on the cat and won't bother the cat at all.
Yeah.
And other stuff I'm sure we'll find out. You know, we're going to have the maintenance come here and tell us more or what they do or whatever.
Yeah.
But, you know, we either picked them up from a friend's place or just like a box of stuff we got earlier last month or something. But now that we know what they are, we can do it a lot better. And, you know, I slept good last night. And it's like finally knowing exactly what it is and how to deal with it. And
yeah.
Yeah, it's a huge relief.
That's good. I remember, like, on the news, one day they were saying that there's, like, some kind of outbreak of that or something. I never heard of them before. I guess we even got them up here somewhere. But I don't know.
Yeah, I mean, you know, I've heard about them in news stories, like, you know, it's Brody was saying earlier, like motels and hotels, whatever.
Yeah.
You check the bed and stuff. But I never, you know, never came across it myself. Neither is Lisa, so.
Yeah. Weird.
Yeah. Bastard.
Yeah.
Yeah, like, I think, from what I've read and heard, I think they're only attracted to, like, humans. Like, I don't, like, dogs and other animals don't carry them. They're, like, they're just after our blood.
Yeah.
That's weird.
wonder what they are like. What do they do in nature, you know? Like when they're not in somebody's bed.
So Peter's going to be having a big house party tomorrow. Everybody's invited.
Oh, Lisa says that white powder is diatomaceous earth, it's called.
Oh, isn't that the stuff you put on your tomatoes? I think that is.
Maybe.
Put around your tomatoes and gets rid of, like, I don't know, the tomato suckers. So, Tim Phillips and Super Killer both in the chat. How's it going, guys? What about you, Brody? How was your week?
Pretty good. Does Jay want to talk movies this early?
Oh, we could possibly be out of now. We haven't already beat to death.
I kind of plunged with everybody else and went to see Mad Max. I actually really liked it.
Oh, did you? Oh, okay. It's pretty good then, huh?
Yeah, I thought it was like it had that 80s action movie feel to me. I've missed for a while.
Yeah. Well, if it had that, maybe I'll like it too then.
I mean, it's the first movie I've seen in a long time where, like, I'd be willing to go back and give him more money to watch it again.
Yeah.
In the theater, you know. I watch it in IMAX, 3D. It's pretty badass.
That's cool. It's pretty cool.
Other than that, my wife's brother died. My brother in law.
Yeah. I guess we are over talking movies. Nobody's got any comments. I watched, let's see, it was on the repeat channel, but it was like Return of the Creature of the Black Lagoon. I guess that was originally in 3D, too.
Oh, really?
Yeah. I noticed they had, like, a lot of cheesy, you know, like, this guy's swimming at you, and he's like, they're sticking, like, a pole in your face, and, you know, all that kind of stuff. It's jumping out of the, off the TV.
I didn't know they did 3D back then.
Yeah, that's back when you had to wear those ridiculous paper glasses.
Yeah.
Oh, with the red and blue?
Yeah.
Okay, yeah, I remember.
Yeah, it was 3D, and then also, but still in black and white, which I don't think I've ever seen a black and white film in 3D. But of course, that was before my time. Pretty wild.
Yeah, I don't think I ever saw that.
It's not very good. It's pretty cheesy, yeah.
Yeah.
So they catch him and they try to bring him back to, you know, America, and everything goes to hell. So catch a different one, I guess.
Mm-hmm. Well, I watched the finale of Mad Men.
Oh, yeah? Is that good?
Yeah, I mean, you know, if you like the show, you'll, I guess, like the ending.
That's cool. I'll have to check out Mad Men. I haven't ever watched that.
Yeah.
It's kind of a screwy show.
I think I'm on, like, season 3.
Yeah.
But I don't watch it consecutively. That's, like, every once in a while I'll throw it up and watch a couple episodes here and there. But did you feel like the ending of that show, like, it was good closure to it? To the whole season? Or the whole series?
Yeah. Yeah, it's, you know, it's sends off with the popular characters, and I thought it was good. It wasn't anything, you know, mind blowing.
Really?
It was just okay. You know, this happened, that happened. Here's the end. But you know, like I said, if you like the show, then you like the end.
Yeah. So Tim Phillips says, I saw Fury Road Saturday night and went to the Motor City Comic Con on Sunday.
Oh, there you go.
Motor City, is that Pittsburgh or is that Detroit? Does anybody know?
Detroit, I think.
Sounds
now
like
we get. Yeah, yeah, it sounds like Detroit. I've never been there myself.
Well, Pittsburgh kind of has that. Pittsburgh might be the Steel City Comic Con or something like that, but yeah. Super Killer says, Jeff, check out your Facebook message. And Super Killer, dude, I know you said you Facebook messaged me, but you are messaging somebody else because there is no messages from you on that page.
Check your other folders.
I'm the Jeff Lafferty. I did. I checked them all. It's not in there, dude. I also have an email.
Check your...
Jeff Lafferty illustration at gmail.com if you want to try to message me there. But yeah, your messages aren't coming through, so I don't know.
You know about the other messages on Facebook?
Yeah, right? The other four up on there.
Yeah.
I've bitched about that before. Unless you're like somebody else and I don't know who you are on Facebook. Are you Super Killer on Facebook and I'm talking to you and I don't realize that? Because that can happen.
What's your real name?
Yeah, but I don't know. I saw you said you messaged me last, you know, on Friday show or whatever. I looked. There's nothing in there, man. So I also watched your guys' is the 100 Days of Comics, like last hangout, you know, whatever.
Yeah.
And that was pretty interesting. Is Johannes banned from the group now or what?
No. I loved your comment.
Peter didn't just. I mean, he's got Kevin to just immediately fucking ban his ass.
No.
He's a lot nicer than me. He would have been out of the Artcasters.
He's cool. He had a night. we talked a little bit as whoever was left in the hangout afterwards. Then I talked to Johannes just one-on-one to talk about the Pelican and stuff.
Yeah.
And you know, whatever like mood he was putting out during the show, he was perfectly fine afterwards.
Afterwards, right.
Yeah.
I'm gonna have to watch this. You got me curious.
Yeah, me too.
That's more towards the end, but man, that show just.
Yeah.
I mean, some of our shows like derail, but like they were fucking like four wheeling across the ocean, man. I was not welcome.
But yeah, it was, you know, it was a fun show.
It was pretty fun.
Gaz was there and Q was in the background laughing. It was really funny.
That was hilarious, actually.
Yeah.
She's like back there laughing, like Jay, you know, but then she's like on the delay because she's watching the YouTube channel. So they're like, you know, they say something funny and then they get off on something else and then all of a sudden you hear this like weird laughter in the background.
Oh, wow.
It's pretty old. I don't know. You know, I noticed on that show, like, I think we should actually start, like, putting our names up on this show. Because I noticed, like, on that show, there was, like, one point there was another girl that jumped in, I think, and then she got kicked back out. I don't know who that was. But I was, like, actually watching it because I was doing computer stuff, so I had the screen open beside my other screens. And I, like, would get lost, and I know all you guys, you know what I mean? And then I'd, all of a sudden I'd be, like, looking at, like, Pharaoh's picture, and I'd be like, who's that? I don't know who that is. You know what I mean? It was just weird.
So you don't think it's, like, I don't know, big and blocky and ruins the screen?
No, I don't think so. I mean, because I don't know. On your show, maybe somebody did have it, or I've seen it before. And I think it looks fine.
I think I had mine up.
Yeah. It's like, I mean, it's like, I think like on a normal hangout, like where everybody's talking to the camera, you can like see whose mouth is moving, but like with us, where the camera's going back and forth and it's just a bunch of, you know, disembodied voices and hands drawing, I bet it's like hard for people to follow who don't know us, you know?
Right.
Maybe, yeah.
But anyway, maybe we'll do that next show.
I figure I'm pretty easy to pick out. I'm just the guy that's always airbrushing.
Right. That's true.
There you go. This is mine.
Let me see what... Yeah, see, that's not so bad.
Yeah, see, the only thing I find when you're using the lower third, though, like, when we're watching it, like, in the broadcast with each other, it's full screen, but when it goes onto YouTube, it actually really cuts down on the screen size.
Mm. Well, I have a crappy camera, so it doesn't matter.
Leave yours on, Peter, yeah, and leave. When I watch the show later, I'll kind of...
scope it out.
Yeah.
Okay.
That piece is coming along awesome, Jay. I love that.
Oh, thanks.
Yeah, I was double thread again.
I keep working on and off on it.
Oh, so let's see. We got some comments rolling in. Spy on the chat conversation, see what's going on. The Superkiller says he might have his Facebook security or something up too much, and it's not letting the thing go through. Tim Phillips said he got to talk to Neil Adams for about 15 minutes.
That's cool.
And then Superkiller also said he's not Superkiller on Facebook. He's making it hard to talk to. let's see. And Tim Phillips said he talked to Simon Bisley. He also got to talk to Jose Garcia Lopez.
Yeah.
He didn't speak very good English. Cooler says, wow, Simon, which is awesome. That's really cool. He's one of his all-time favorites. And Tim Phillips said he's a pretty nice guy.
I've always been a fan of Neil Adams' Green Arrow work.
And the Tom Martyr says, if you look at the bottom right, it says the name of the screen. Oh, okay, you're right. Actually, I didn't think about that. If you look at the bottom right, it says the name of the screen you're looking at when it's on the gray box. So, like, when I'm on, you know, camera, it says my name at the bottom. So maybe it is actually just a problem I don't need to worry about.
But it's like, you know, if somebody's part of the hangout but hasn't talked in a long time, you never see their name pop up, so you might lose track of who's, you know, who else is in the chat. I don't know.
Could be. What do you guys think in the chat? Should we do those or not? Or in the comments after the YouTube video goes up? Let's put it to the vote. Put it to the Artcaster.
Like, I think I might be able to, I'm not 100% positive, but just, like, do my logo. So it'll be, like, my logo in the lower left side. So it won't be taking up the whole bottom, whatever, 5 inches or whatever of the screen.
Yeah.
I'll check it. I'll look into that. So.
Jeff, is that a commission you're working on, or are you just doing another Black Widow piece?
I'm going to do another Black Widow. I'm going to paint one and put it up on eBay, see what it goes for.
Are you going to take the drawing to the con?
What?
I said, are you going to take prints of that one to the con that you're doing?
Oh, I kind of doubt it. I might take this original to there, though, because I'll probably still have it at the end of the week, so...
Yeah. It might sell. Maybe it just came out.
it might sell. Yeah, you never know. Then at least I'll have one original. I'm gonna take some drawings though, like partially done drawings, and then work on them during the con, like Jea was telling me. See if I can drum up some commissions and put my full commission prices out there, not just like, you know, little $20 ones.
Right.
Bites on it.
So is that the new casting? Black Widow's new casting?
I don't think so. It's hard to find stuff from the new one. So
I don't know. I haven't seen the movie yet, but just the little scenes with her or the still pictures, I kind of don't like it. But we'll see. You know, because it looks like she's from Tron with the lights. You know.
Yeah, it definitely has a Tron feel like it did.
I haven't watched the new one yet. Have you seen it, Brody? What did you say?
I said just save your money and go see Max. Yeah, I've seen it. I thought it was good. I enjoyed it. Some good parts to it. I thought it was just as good as the first one, but I mean, I still think Max is a better film. Like, I honestly think that Mad Max movie was, you know, I'm saying what everybody else is saying. I think it's the best 2015 so far. It's just, I don't know. Like I said, it had that 80s throwback. You know, it was just a good movie.
That's cool. To check it out.
Very little CGI crap. It was more practical effects, even like all the pyro and the explosions and all that stuff. It was just nice to see it, you know, instead of CG.
Yeah. That sounds pretty cool. I'll have to check that out.
I was sad that they didn't have a Mel Gibson cameo anywhere, but The main bad guy from the original Mad Max, he's the bad guy in this. They brought him back.
Oh, really? That's cool.
Yeah, different character, but same actor.
Yeah.
Which one? The awesome sauce guy?
I'm trying to think. I'm trying to think what his name was. Burn. Something Burn, I think.
And he was the bad guy from
Mad Max, the biker gang leader, that guy?
Yeah, the gang leader.
Oh, okay.
Cool. So did they have guys in assless chaps in this one?
No, but it definitely had the feel of the post-apocalyptic clothing and all that stuff, and the weapons and the cars. But yeah, thankfully no assless chaps.
Assless.
Yeah, that would have been a sight to see in 3D.
Were there like any boobs in it, like in Road Warrior?
Actually, I don't remember much nudity, if any. Actually,
I saw it, and there wasn't. Hey guys.
Hey.
There was like one scene where there was a girl who's naked, but you didn't really see anything. They just, they took like the camera shots from different angles, so you didn't really see. I was kind of surprised because it was rated R, but I don't know. I thought they could have got away with like a PG-13 rating, and that's not like a bad thing. Usually it's a bad thing, I think, when they try to make, do that, but.
Mm-hmm.
It was definitely violent, but it wasn't like gratuitous. I mean, there were so many opportunities where they could have like crushed people under cars and had their heads split open and stuff, which they didn't do any of that stuff. But there was any cursing in the whole movie either. So I don't know. I'm not really sure. It seems like it would have made more sense for them to make it a PG-13. But
yeah.
So Tim Phillips said the best artist I saw there was Mike Mayhew. His originals don't do the printed work any justice. I scrutinized it, and he was there to answer my questions. Talked to him for quite a while. And
scrutinized his work?
Well, yeah, really. Probably wasn't that hard on him. I was like, he's a fan. Said he had a high school Parker and Mary Jane in front of... Sorry, I can't read this morning. In front of Spidey symbol, like the classic cover. It wasn't used, but it was breathtaking, especially considering the size it was done. And Tim Phillips says Mad Max was the best movie seen in 20 years. Wow.
Yeah, it was good. Scott, did you see 3D?
No, I didn't. I usually don't opt for the 3D thing.
Yeah, me either, but I figured if I was going to see that, I might as well spend the extra money and get my money's worth.
Yeah, my friend went to see it later, and he went to see it. I don't know if you guys have this thing that, they might call it something else, but here at the theater over here, they got this thing called the D-Box seats. Where the seats actually, like, move, like, with the movie.
No.
Yeah, like, they rock and stuff, and depending on what's going on. So, I've never done it before. He hasn't either, but he was going to tell me. Because I wasn't sure if it would put you more into the movie or take you out of it.
Hmm.
I'll have to wait and hear from him what he says.
I did something like that in Las Vegas one time. At like a movie, and then the seats like rocked around, and it was interesting. Yeah. I don't know if I wanted it in every movie though. It was kind of fun, I guess.
I heard they were doing something like that for the San Andreas movie.
Oh, jeez, yeah. Yeah, because I'm hoping that the Mad Max movie does. I think they already committed to sequels and stuff, but.
Yeah, there's like four more, I read.
Oh, really? Yeah, because, I don't know if it did as well as they were hoping, because I think that Pitch Perfect made like $70 million, and I think...
That blows me away. Pitch Perfect came in number one at the box office.
Yeah.
You're like, really? People want to still watch these singing competitions?
Yeah, well, because me and my girlfriend went to the movie at the same time, and we split up, and she went and saw Pitch Perfect. And
I used to...
Man,
I saw the first one and I thought it was good, you know.
What, Pitch Perfect?
Yeah.
Okay, do you watch, like, what's that show, Glee?
No. No, it was just Lisa wanted to see it, and we went, and I enjoyed it.
I don't know, teen musicals or, you know, post-apocalyptic crushing cars and guns. I don't know which way I'm going.
I'm not saying I'd watch Mad Max over, you know. I mean, I saw the original. I didn't see the new sequel. But
just combine them into one type of movie and then...
Well, I was going to say, for the next one, they should do Mad Max the musical. It would just dominate.
Casually, like trying to get across the desert and get picked up. Yeah, I don't get the Glee thing. I actually tried to watch it a couple times just because I was like, why are everybody talking about this? And
oh, that show is something else, man. I don't know.
Timothy says the D-Box isn't worth it. I think they're D-bags for making them.
Well, you don't have to do it, I mean, but...
That's right. You don't have to watch. You don't have to participate.
Yeah, I wonder if it's worth it for the theater, because, like, most of the time I go into a theater that has those, there's usually hardly anyone in them, you know, sitting in those seats. Every once in a while you'll see, and there's a row of them. It's either a row or two rows, and you'll be lucky if there's like four people in it. So I don't know. What's that?
I was gonna say, do you know what the price difference is to get those?
I haven't done it. Whatever extra costs for 3D, it probably costs that much extra for the D-box seats, maybe more. I don't know. I'm not sure. I'll do it at one time just to see what it's all about. But I'm just, to me, that's all gimmicky stuff. I kind of feel this, for the most part, I feel the same about 3D, you know?
Yeah. I actually don't really like the 3D either. I just forget all about it. Like, after, you know, if a movie's decent, I just totally space out that it's even in 3D. And,
yeah.
You know?
The 3D is good, but the film is actually darker. You know, it's dimmer. I'd rather see the regular version.
Yeah. And then Timothy Phillips says a lot of schools bought out the entire theaters for their students for Pitch Perfect.
What the hell is going on with the kids today? This is not good.
They did it for Mad Max. I'll be like, yes, America.
Singing will never solve any of life's problems.
So it's on Friday, all my students were talking about seeing Pitch Perfect. They didn't even know what Mad Max was. Tim Phillips said that.
Oh, my God.
What a shame.
That is. That is. It's funny, I don't even know this Pitch Perfect movie. I guess I haven't seen the commercials for it or anything.
It just looks like a bunch of teenagers dancing around and singing.
Yeah.
I don't think they're teenagers, but...
All right, well, early 20-somethings dancing around and singing, which is even better.
Yeah. Yeah, I don't know. That's what we're coming to. Kids today.
Yeah, because when the world actually, you know, turns into a post-apocalyptic world, like, you know, if it's going to be an apocalypse, it's not going to be like The Walking Dead. It's going to be like Mad Max. They're just going to, what are they going to rely on, singing their way out of it?
It's never going to happen. I've been waiting for that since I was freaking 17. The Super Killer says 3D IMAX is the only 3D worth watching, and Will Cook says kids suck. I don't know. I mean, kids are into what they're into, right? So I'm sure there's some kids digging Mad Max and everything.
Oh, also, I saw that Maggie movie with Schwarzenegger, the zombie flip with him in it.
Oh, yeah?
That's a zombie?
Yeah, to tell you the truth, it was slower. It was, like, really slow for a zombie film, but I actually really liked it because it was different than every other zombie film you're going to see. Instead of a bunch of zombies running around and then focusing on, like, multi-character stories, they just focus on one family's ordeal with it. And, I mean, so it was a slower-paced film, but, I mean, it lets you focus, you know, on the reality of what was going on, and I thought it was pretty good.
Yeah, I'm kind of surprised of some. I haven't seen a lot of them, but some of these new Schwarzenegger movies are actually pretty good. What was the one? There was one I saw that I was. It was just an action film, but they did some things that I had never seen in an action film before. It was the one where he was like the small town sheriff.
Oh, Last Stand or.
Yeah. There's this whole scene where there's this car chase like in a cornfield, and it was just cool because these cars are like. Trying to find each other in this cornfield, driving around, and it just, again, that's just something I'd never seen before. I thought it was kind of a neat thing, so I don't know.
Yeah.
It makes me wonder how the Terminator films can be, since they've done so many of them.
Yeah, I don't know. We'll see. I'm curious about it, because I don't... It's like I watched that trailer and, you know, John Connor's sort of a half Terminator or something. I'm just wondering, I'm curious about it, what it
That's
is.
That's the one I'm really wondering about.
Is it really? I didn't pick that.
It just seems like, I don't know, I want them messing with the myth, man. That first movie is like so perfect.
Yeah, but they've already killed it. Like, it's been killed. Twice.
Well, at least this one's supposed to be Schwarzenegger in the whole thing. Like, he's supposed to be a main role again instead of just, like, filling parts.
Yeah, but it's just, like, I don't know. Like, I'm more, like, you know, I like the, in the first movie, the whole John Connor, you know, all that stuff. The guy that comes back and says, "Dad, I don't want him to fuck it up," you know. Just looks kind of, it looks goofy, but it's like, I totally want to see it, though. And I haven't wanted to see a Terminator movie ever since, like, the third one, I think. The theme it says, singing will never solve any of the life's problems. I thought it was funny. So anybody got any art news?
Yeah, my concert.
Did you see the no, last week?
There's no more seeing this and that. Let's talk cons.
I was talking about they sold the Pablo Picasso painting.
Oh, no.
Like $179 million.
Jeez.
Some pretty good money for somebody.
It's not Picasso.
No. He used that to buy his way out of art hell.
No. Why don't you tell us about your convention, Brody? How'd that go?
Yeah, I kind of feel you a little bit, like, but, alright, so, they promote so much cosplay at these shows now. It was just a one-day show. I used to do pretty well at them, but this show was like, I made my expenses back, plus just a little bit extra take home. Definitely not worth the 5-hour round trip to do the show, but it's like they focus so much on these cosplay costume contests, and, like, in their advertisements, there's so much focused on, like, cosplay guests, costume contest, you know, and they used to do cosplay guests getting free, you know, you don't have to pay a ticket if you come in costume and all this shit, so it's like they don't promote the artists enough, and it's like when these people come, they just come to see this, the costume contest or hang out with the cosplay guests or in costume, it's like they don't come to spend money, and it's just not, I don't know, it's not what it used to be. And that's nothing against cosplay. It's no fault of their own. I mean, it's the show promotion. But I can't really bitch too much. I made my money back and a little bit extra in pocket. But it's like if they spend as much time placing the artists, you know, considerably instead of focusing so much on cosplay, I think a lot of people will do a lot better. I was beside a guy who had, like, one of those big PVC photography backdrops that we were talking about, and he had prints all over that, and he basically had the same type of artwork I was selling, but 50 plus images, you know, 50 more images than I had, and, you know, so people were gravitating to his table because he had more to look at and flip through, so it's a bad placement for me, and I don't know, not enough promotion, I guess, but I need to do a bigger show. Those are small town shows. I need to do something like Heroes Con in North Carolina or something like that.
Who was the artist that next to you?
You know, I think his name was Scott, but I can't remember his last name. And he actually drove from, I think he said he had a 6-hour drive, and he barely made enough to like say it was worth it. He said the only reason that he wasn't really pissed off is because he sold $300 or $400 on eBay like that morning. So he wasn't too upset. You know, he made his money for the day.
And his name's Scott, and he's like,
Giant Booth? Yeah, that sounds familiar.
He's... All right, he's a short guy, he's bald. Fucking 30s, I don't... His name's Scott, I can't...
That wasn't me, I don't... I've never made $400 off eBay, so...
Well, I don't know, I mean, I watch people on eBay, so it's kind of like... I might have ran across him. But what was he selling? Like movie art? Like superheroes?
Yeah, like, okay, so he had like, alright, he did both like digital illustration and like traditional stuff, so he had the same kind of stuff that I had. His digital illustration stuff, though, he did a lot of like negative space vector stuff. It wasn't like detailed, it was just vector art. Mm. And then his movie art, his entertainment art, was like black and white, again, negative space, but he would do it with, like, ink and brush.
Mm.
I'm not big on that stuff, but he did really well, so I guess a lot of people are. Really nice guy, but yeah, he said he drove like 6 hours. That was his first one-day show. He said he doubts he's going to do another one.
Which what was this convention?
Virginia Comic Con in Richmond,
okay. Virginia. Is that a pretty big one, or is it a smaller show, or?
I mean, they tell you that they're going to have 1,000-plus people, which is okay for a one-day show, but
1,000.
There definitely wasn't 1,000-plus people there, because the same people passed my table, like, repeatedly.
Yeah, it's not.
Sounds like it was just too small.
And, like I said, I usually do really well at those shows. I actually did better at the first one-day show I did versus the two-day show that I did with them. The first two-day show, but then the last two-day show, I did better than I did at this one-day show. So it's like, it's hit or miss, you know.
Well, I know you said, like, you were kind of, like, the guy beside you kind of overwhelmed you with his booth. Like, how much stuff did you have, like, when at your table to show?
Like, my table was completely full. Like, I didn't have any more space on my table. I actually had to tape a bunch of, like, extra prints to the front of my table. Like, hang them off the front of the tablecloth or whatever. But he had, like, one of those, like Scott has, he has one of those backdrops, and he had all his prints, like, extra prints on that. He had, like, binders full of sketch cards. He had boxes full of prints that people could flip through.
Yeah, because, I mean, like, I know, like, we were messaging each other on the weekend there, and
yeah.
I kind of told you my theory, and, I mean, I've been doing shows for 20 years, and my theory is always with the booth, like, absolutely go big or go home. Like, just have the biggest, most outrageous thing that you could put together. Like, hopefully next year I'll be able to do something like Scott where it can be 100 feet tall. But
it won't let me go that high.
Yeah. No, but, you know, like, because I got, like, a big 10-foot backdrop and, you know, the tables with all the display stuff and whatnot. Like, it's literally impossible for somebody to walk by within 50 feet and not see it, you know?
Yeah.
Because when I first started doing shows, way back in the day, yeah, I had, like, a little table and my easel if I was painting or something. But over the years, the louder you make your booth, definitely the more attention you get and the more, well, I don't, like, make on-point sales, but the more, you know, commissions I'll get from it.
It also has to do with what you're selling, too, because your stuff has more, like, mass appeal. Because even with the booth as big as I am, it doesn't... My stuff doesn't appeal to everyone, so some people just walk right by it, and this is kid stuff, or this is looks like Nickelodeon or something like that. So it depends on what you're selling, too.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, definitely.
Yeah.
Well, like, my brother went with me to this show, and it's like, to get an extra chair, pay, like, another fucking $25 just for his chair. And it used to be that they just gave you two chairs with your six-foot table. And this time,
I gave two chairs.
Just bring one.
Yeah.
Or if you have to fly, or that's a different story.
Like, you couldn't. They wouldn't let you bring one. And,
really?
Even if you brought an infant in, you had to pay for a ticket. Like, they switched. They do it at the Richmond Raceway Complex, so now they're charging infants. What parent's going to pay for an infant ticket? I don't know, but I just...
Oh, my God.
Seems like it's going downhill, you know?
It's a ripoff.
Yeah, it's not a really shitty show, man.
Yeah,
that
sounds like a shitty show. How much was the tables? I don't remember what you told me, or do you want to say?
All right, so this one doesn't make a lot of sense to me. The last one-day show I did was in a smaller space at a hotel, and I paid $125 for my table, and it included my extra chair. This time, and that's, okay, so if I didn't get an extra chair, say my brother didn't go and it was just me, I would have had to pay that $125 regardless. There was no discount for not having an extra person. This time the table was like $80, $25 for the extra chair, and yeah, it's just, I don't know, it doesn't make any sense. And it was in a bigger space, so I guess you think you'd pay more because the space is bigger, like they'd be renting a bigger space at a raceway complex. So yeah.
Well, if I was only paying $80 for a table, I don't probably wouldn't mind so much paying an extra $20 for a chair, but but $80 is pretty cheap for. Like you said, if they're under 1,000 people there, then maybe not. Maybe, you know.
If that just sounds like a super small con, I would think that would be a lot about, you know, trying to make your money at that one.
Yeah,
There's just not enough people to buy stuff, you know?
Well, like I said, like
one-day con, you know?
Yeah, well, I did a one-day show. I did their one-day show when it was at the smaller location at the hotel.
Yeah.
And I did really well. So I'm thinking, okay, well, it's going to be in a Raceway complex that can hold more people. I'm going to do even better. And it was actually the opposite. So how that logic makes any sense, I don't know.
Yeah.
Like I said, I think it has a lot to do with, you know, the promotion of just, I don't know, focusing on cosplay versus the promotion of the artist.
How do they...
Kind of doubt it.
It just doesn't seem like... It doesn't seem like that's a good business spent, a good business practice for them. If how do they make money? How do they make more money off of bringing in cosplayers? I mean, I guess attendance maybe, but if
well,
they're letting people in for free.
Because the artists pay for their rental. I mean, they charge us the table fees and we pay for the space. Right. So they just focus on cosplay, and the cosplay is not making
the money. Artists aren't making money, they ain't coming back.
That's true.
Well, every con, I mean, it's just cosplay is just part of Comic Cons now. There's just no, you know, separating it out anymore. You know, just like movie stars or whatever.
I don't have anything against cosplay. I have tons of friends that do it. I used to do the special effects makeup. I've done a lot of makeup for people in cosplay, but it's like not their fault. I mean, the show promoters though should spend as much time promoting the artists that even the independent artists that aren't celebrities at their shows as they do promoting their cosplay guests.
I don't know. I mean, I just think that there's nobody reading, you know, there's some people reading comics, but just, you know, most people that, you know, might go to a con, just, you know, the people who, like, already are into comics and stuff, they already know there's a con, you know what I mean? Those people are going to come irregardless. Like, the celebrities and shit, they just bring in more people, you know? I mean, I don't see cosplay as a bad thing. I see it actually as a very good thing for comics.
I think Brody's saying that that's all they concentrate on, and you can't do that. I mean, you got to service everyone from cosplayers to, you know, just regular people just checking it out to the people that are buying tables. And
Yeah,
I don't think it's a bad thing at all. I mean, the more people, the better. I just wish that the artist got equal exposure as far as promotion goes. Like,
no, it just really sounds like it's a shitty
replacement is for a smaller show with less artists. It seems like they could spend a little more time placing people better. I've done their shows numerous times. They've asked me to guest judge numerous costume contests. Like for example, the first show I did, they asked me to come do a makeup demo. That's when I was doing strictly effects, and that's when I worked with Jim Kohorik, who works for Avatar Press and did like Freddy vs. Jason vs. Ash. We did a makeup demo where they shot the makeup for, like, I guess one of his comics that's coming out. That was strictly something he wanted to do and asked me to come. So then they asked me to guest judge the costume contest with Yaya Han, which was, like, their cosplay guest. So that gave me, like a status with all the cosplay attendees. Like, who's this guy? You know, he does makeup. He must be somebody. So I got a lot of traffic to my table. I did really good at that show. And I've done other shows with this con after that. So it seems like with a smaller one-day show with less artists, it would take a little more consideration of where they place me or any other artist. You know, you wouldn't want to put two indie comic book creators side by side. Like, a lot of cons will try to break up, you know, people that are selling their own books and put like, just a print artist or somebody in between them or a celebrity guest or something like that in between them to break it up. Smaller shows seem to be able to do that, but they didn't. And it's like, that's all I'm saying. I wish they would give more consideration to the artists and the layout of their show instead of just focusing on, like, promoting their costume contests and their cosplay panels and all that stuff, you know?
Yeah.
You know, DD has a girl crush on you, Yaya.
Oh, really?
Yes,
She's actually super nice in person. Like, that show that she was on Sci-Fi, that made it seem like she was a bitch or whatever, but she's actually a super sweet person. Super nice.
Let's see. So anyway, Tim Phillips says there was almost no cosplayers at the con. This one was, I can't read this part. I'm sorry.
this one was for once about comic art and the vendors, even the media guests weren't a big presence. And that was like the Detroit Con or Motor City Con, which that's a big con. That surprises me.
So what were they focusing on if they weren't focusing on, you know, Walking Dead and
like the new issues of Spider-Man or something? I mean, anybody give a shit about that? And he says, when Neil Adams heading up the show, you know it's about comics. I mean, that guy's like a genre.
Yeah, something else this show was doing, and I don't know if it's like typical for other shows, because I haven't done other shows outside of this specific con, but they were doing like no on-site cash ticket sales.
What do you mean? Like no ticket booth? Just to buy tickets to get in?
Like you had to go online and order your ticket before you came to the show or you weren't getting in.
That's pretty fucked up.
Yeah, so I have a feeling that has a lot to do with the money I made, but who's to say, you know?
It sounds like everything that's wrong with conventions that they do was happening there.
Well, I know a lot of the artists that, like, the typical artists that always come back do really well, but they're also getting comped, you know, their table. They don't pay for their table because of the regulars to the show. They draw in, people know who they are, so people come to see that artist. It's difficult. I mean, it's hard to decide what you're going to do because, like I said, where I live, I'm driving. Like, that show is the closest one to me, and that's 2.5 hours each way. I really have to pick and choose what show I'm doing. And there's the resort that I live on, they do a fireworks show every 4th of July, and they have, like, a Bryce Fest. Because it's Bryce Resort, they do, like, a Bryce Fest the day of the fireworks from 10 a.m. to 6 p.m., with vendors, and tables are like $85 for a 10x10 space, but you have to bring your own table and your own tent or whatever. I was thinking about doing those. I mean, trying to set up there. I just don't know. I don't know enough about it, I guess. I guess I'm just inexperienced. I haven't done enough shows.
Super Killer says, I can't imagine going through all the effort to make $100 or so. Tim Phillips says, as much as I hung out in Artist Alley, I didn't see any money changing hands. And he did pick up 10 Marvel Essentials books for $5. And then Dee Dee says, I did hear Yaya hat. Anyway, Dee Dee's in the chat. She heard what you said.
Yeah, I don't know. I mean, you know, it's hard to tell what's going on, you know, like when you're walking around Artist Alley, people are like selling or not selling or, you know, what.
And it's not like I'm just assuming people didn't come for the artist. Like, I literally, people would stop by the table and, like, look at my stuff and, like, compliment it and say that they wish they brought money. Oh, I wish I brought money. I'm like, I knew you were coming. Like, what happened? Like, what do you mean you didn't bring money? Oh, we came for the costume contest.
Yeah.
I'm like, okay. So that's where I'm getting my whole thought process on.
Yeah. I mean, to me, like, a con that's, like, you know, touting, like, we're going to get 1,000 people through the door, it's just, like, that's just, like, such a small con. I don't know how I could judge anything. You know what I mean? To me, like, that's the problem right there. It's, like, there's no attendees, you know.
It just really sounds like a crappy show. Like, I mean...
Like 1,000 people.
How long has this show been around? Every show has to start somewhere. Do you know how long they've been around, Brody?
I want to say, I feel like they've been doing the one-day shows for 3 or 4 years now, and they just started doing the two-day shows in 2013. Okay. And it's just a one-time-a-year thing. Like, they do a two-day show in November, and then, like, every other month they do, like, a one-day show, or every 3 months they'll do a one-day show. But, I mean, it's, and, you know, like, the first couple shows I did with them, I thought they were really a really good convention because they didn't have a lot of celebrity guests other than celebrity artists. Like, they didn't have movie stars and all that stuff. They had Yaya, which is great because she met the cosplay needs for all the cosplayers. That she drew a lot of people in. and that was a 2-day show, so they brought her in for that. But they don't bring in, like, you know, movie stars and things like that, so the focus was on artists and celebrity guest artists. But it's like now it seems like it's changing. It's like the gears are changing and they're switching their schematic, and it's, I don't know, it's just, it's different.
Yeah.
And like I said, the artists that have been doing the show since day one, they don't complain. They do really well because people associate their name with that con. So they come and they always spend money at their table and they do really well. But smaller indie guys like me who can't afford to do every single show or can't make it because I live, you know, 3 hours away, it makes it difficult. I'm just going to take this money that I made at this show and get one of those backdrops, like Jay said, and just go big, try to stand out a little bit better.
Well, I think that definitely helps. I mean, the more stuff you got, the more you're going to sell, you know. That just makes sense, maybe.
I hate coming off like I'm bitter about it, because I'm really not. Like, anytime I say anything about cosplay, like somebody does cosplay but listen to the show probably thinks I fucking hate cosplay, but I don't, you know. It's not that. It's just I try to decide, like, business-wise, like, what's working and what's not and why things aren't going the way that they were at the same show with the same people before. And, you know, that's what I came up with. But
yeah.
Could just be me.
Well, I mean, you know, I don't know. I hear it a lot, and it's just, I just don't understand it, to tell you the truth. Like, the cosplay thing, I mean, I understand where you're coming from, but, you know, it sucks to have a bad show, but I don't see that the movie stuff, the cosplay stuff is hurting comics. I mean, they're, like, bigger than ever, and everybody goes, oh, well, those people aren't reading comics. Those people aren't blah, 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 you know. I mean, it's just like, I totally did comics back in the 90s and shit, and the cons sucked, you know. You went to San Diego because it was, like, the only fucking decent con. Cons in Colorado were, like, a freaking, you know, basement in the Holiday Inn, and, you didn't make any money at those things, you know? There weren't any, like, cosplayers or girls, let alone, you know, at these things either. It's freaking lame.
Yeah.
You know? You guys want to go back to that when the focus was on comics? I mean, fuck that, you know?
Well, I think a lot of people say, like, get pissed off about the celebrity thing is not so much of them being there, it's the, like, what they charge and the prices, and, you know, they connect that to the fact that they think people spend so much money to get the autographs of those people that they don't have any money left over to spend in Artist Alley. So I think that's where they're coming from. Me, I don't feel entitled to anybody's money. People work hard for their money, they can spend it wherever they want. If they like my stuff and they buy it, cool. If they don't, then that's their prerogative. But I'm strictly thinking about, like, the promotion. Like, I think that could step up and be a little bit better.
Yeah. Well, it sounds like it. Probably getting that.
Honestly, if they're going to promote the celebrity so much or the cosplay, then make it equal for the artists that are attending there who are spending the money.
Well, why would they do that, though, dude? I mean, if you're going to, like, promote it and the guy from Firefly is going to be there, it's just like, you know, that's going to get some people. If they're going to promote it and tell you that Brody Williams is going to be there, people are going to be like, well, what's that? Who's that?
We're paying $300 to $500 or more for tables to pay for those guys to be there.
But
so
the guy from Firefly is going to get guys in the door. You're not going to get anybody in the door, you know? They might buy something once they're there and they see you're there, but I mean, it just doesn't make any sense, you know?
Well, I think Phoenix, and I'm sure Denver's the same way. I mean, they do. I mean, they need to treat the people that are paying to bring in those big guys with respect, whether they're not bringing people in the doors or not. They're, like Brody says, they're paying for them. I mean, you can't treat them like shit, you know?
Yeah, I agree, and I'm not saying that, but, you know, it's like the Denver Comic Con commercials are, like, on, you know, TV right now, and the guy pulls up in a DeLorean, he jumps out, he says, you know, come to the Denver Comic Con, and, you know, Stanley's face flashes on the screen, you know what I mean? It's just, they're not, like, flashing, like, you know, random artist number 14 doing fan art, you know?
Well, I don't think, like, I don't know, I don't think Brody, well, I'm not going to speak for him, but it's not that you don't promote, like, independent guys to bring people into the show, but you you work as far as the placement of the tables to make sure that they're, you know, that they're, I don't know, that, yeah, I'm not a con guy. I mean, I don't run a con, but there's ways you can make, you know, or at least try to make everyone happy, you know.
Yeah, you treat them all as equal at the convention. You know, do you want anything? No, I'm serious. Like, I've been treated well at conventions.
Yeah.
You know.
Well, I'm not getting down on you, Brody. I don't mean to come off like, you know, a jerk or whatever. But, you know, no, I just think it's kind of.
It's hard to say what I'm trying to like think, like what I'm thinking, without it kind of coming out the wrong way. Like what Scott said, I don't expect to flash my name or my picture, promote me in that way. But it's like the consideration of where we're placed. I think that they can do a little bit better job so that, okay, for example, like they say, if you buy a ticket early, then you're going to get the best table. Like, that's how some shows do it. If you buy your ticket early, it's first come, first serve. That's bullshit, because the people that are getting their tables comped and aren't paying, they're still ahead of you. They're still closer to the door. And it's like they're not big celebrities. They're just friends of the people at the show. And it's just like, I don't know. It just pisses me off a little bit, I guess. I'm on a rant. I guess I'm on a rant about it.
Why? I don't know. But how do you decide, you know, who gets a decent table? And, you know, it's all random, you know, until you get everybody in there and you get one guy next to another. And, like, when I'm at, like, Denver Comic Con, I'm sitting in, like, you know, a freaking sea of artists, you know? I mean, it's just like, who knows who I'm going to be up against, you know? I mean, I could be sitting right next to, like, Neil Adams, and he could be stealing all my sales, you know what I mean?
You haven't seen the layout yet?
Well, yeah, I have, but, you know, it just... Right. I didn't have anything to say about where I went, you know, where I'm sitting.
Right.
So let's see. Tim Phillips says, I know what you're saying, Brody, I agree. And then he says, with Jeff also. He kind of agree with Paul.
One or the other.
No, I don't think that we're like that... You know, I mean, I'm not trying to, like I said, be a jerk or come down or whatever. I just think, you know, it's, I don't know, you know. Got to kind of look at it from outside, like, the perspective of, like, the con also.
If I could say something, I'd, sure, you know, Jim. You guys do your comic conventions, and, like, I mean, I do bike shows and custom shows and whatnot. And there's a whole other side to conventions that I don't even think that you guys get to see. For the fact, like I say, I want to have a booth. You know, you guys pay $100 for a day or $300 for a weekend. I pay almost $2,000 for a weekend. I have no say in where I'm going, who's beside me. I could have a Harley booth beside me. I could have the motorcycle museum beside me. I could have a booth selling calendars with girls in bikinis beside me. Like, I have no say in it. So for me, when I do a show, it's a $2,000 investment minimum. Like, you kind of, it's winner takes all. Like, you got to go into it like it's a war zone. That's why I said, like, I do a booth that try to make the biggest, baddest booth that I can within my means, and I don't get to bitch and complain about it.
Yeah.
Yeah, it sounds like it's a entirely different world. Maybe we're a little spoiled.
Dee Dee did say something about you. It says, not sure if Jay mentioned his giveaway on IG. You talking about something we don't know about?
Oh, I'm
Is that Instagram, IG?
Yeah.
Okay.
I'm giving away some Walking Dead prints, a set of my Walking Dead prints on there.
Oh, cool.
All you got to do is follow me and like the post, and you might win.
Definitely, I'm in the running?
Everybody's in the running.
So anyway, Tim Phillips says, I just don't like when my son, which I didn't bring this time, But when it's so busy you can't move, let alone when my son gets lost.
This year would have San Diego or New York or something.
Yeah, and I actually hate that, yeah. Like when you're caught, it's like the lines just don't move, it's so clogged. He said this year I would have been comfortable bringing him. It was busy, but I could breathe. Oh, cons. Aren't they fun?
Do you guys do anything pre-con to really promote it that you're going to be there?
Just on Facebook, and probably today I'm going to change like all my avatars that show, you know, show what booth I'm at and stuff, and then I'll start posting, pictures of things I'm going to bring, and just, but, you know, I don't have a huge reach, so I do what I can, but yeah, you definitely want to, and, you know, you really, I should be promoting that stuff year-round, but it seems like I promote a lot more when I get closer to Comic-Con, but.
Yeah, I don't do anything other than this show.
I try to promote on Facebook, but it's like most of the people that come to those shows like aren't connected with me on Facebook. Even though I hand out 500 cards, you know, when I'm there, it's like I hand out so many cards, I run out of cards. But it's like they don't follow up and like the page, or I don't know.
Yeah, it's tough to.
But Jeff, what you're saying, like people that like really aren't familiar with comic culture or comic books anymore, you're right, because I had a guy come up and that Star Wars sketch cover that I did.
Yeah.
He's like, oh, so they put these out with pencil artwork on them now? And you know, I had to explain to him what a sketch cover was and how that worked. And
well, yeah, but I mean, that's a relatively new thing.
Yeah, like, I don't mind doing that. It's good. It's a good conversation starter. But, yeah, a lot of people, they don't know.
I just barely found out about sketch covers, though, you know? So I could kind of see that. It's like a new thing to me, too, really. Like, when that guy commissioned it, I think that was the first I had heard of him, really. But I'm not, like, in the comic shops all the time, too. Maybe I'd have known about it earlier if I hung out there more often. Did you get anything sold, though? Any of the originals?
Oh, yeah. Originals? No. I made all my money, like, all my table money back, and a little extra that I made for my expenses and stuff, just on prints. And it's weird, like, I had my sketch covers, like, at $65, or the Star Wars one at $65, and then it didn't sell. A lot of people looked at it and liked it, but it didn't sell. And then I got home, and I listed it on eBay for $80, buy it now, or $65 auction, and I had it off, like, a little over a day, and I got bought it out of Florida. So, nice.
Well, that's cool.
But I was going to ask you, is there a certain time that, like, listing stuff on eBay is better?
Well, I think listing at night is better than, you know, having something in either in the middle of the night or, like, during the day, because people are busy, you know what I mean? They might not be able to get your auction.
Like, between, like, 6 and 9 o'clock?
Yeah, I'd say that's probably perfect, like, 7. I usually list around 7. And, I don't know if it's true or not, but a lot of people think that listing, you know, have your listings in on Friday, Saturday, or Sunday works better because people still have their money that they got paid. I don't know if that's true, though. I never really helped with that one.
So I just remembered the alien piece that I did. That was bought by my friend Paul Kijiji, and cool. I mailed it out to him. He just received it.
Oh, wow.
It's like, I think it took like 2.5 weeks or something. I don't know.
Man.
You know, he's in Australia, so. And I didn't, you know, he's like, don't put a rush on it. And I was like, You know, I'm just mailing it.
That's like, I wonder what they do. They just like throw it on a boat or something? I mean, you know, you'd think like if they just stick it on a plane, it should get there faster than that, but yeah, I don't know.
Well, as long as it got there safely, that's, you know, I was worried.
Yeah.
Like, did you get that yet? And he's like, I didn't check the mail. It's like, I don't know. I guess that's a process out there to check your mail, but it's like, I do that every day. I don't know.
Yeah. Well, that's cool that he bought it, though. That's awesome.
Yeah. I got other packages I got in mail. I'm so, like, convoluted, I feel like. I mean, especially this past month, it's like I'm not on top of anything. But now I should be getting much more on track. I'm going to do a new Patreon video, which I'll post Wednesday. Not sure exactly. I have a lot of ideas, but I might just keep it simple. I'm not sure.
That's cool. Are you talking about like changing like your main video and Patreon?
Yeah, I want to do a new video and just, you know, sort of keep that relatively simple, and update the page. You know, I know there's better ways of designing a page. You know, just really get back into doing videos.
Yeah.
I've been so off track with that lately.
Yeah. I noticed, I actually thought that same thing about redesigning my, Patreon video, because like when I put that up, I, you know, it was quite a while ago, and the way I do things now is like quite a bit different. You know, I don't do like the weekly videos anymore and stuff. And it's weird. I couldn't get the main video to change, and I don't know if that was just something that was going on when I was trying to do it or what. But I don't know. I put it in that page a couple times and just would not like switch. It just kept, you know, going back to the one I had originally uploaded, so hopefully they fix that, or I was doing it wrong. So I was having a real problem with that, yeah. That's why I asked.
I mean, I didn't switch the video, but I just put a, you know, new video coming soon or whatever.
Yeah.
Over the old one.
And oh, and it that fixed was, it?
Well, the image, you know, like it had the video cover before, but I put up a new placeholder, same video but different image that you see, and that was easy. That didn't have a problem with that.
Okay.
Let's see if I have a problem putting up a new video.
Yeah.
I know that, you know, they have improved things over there. That, you know.
Yeah.
Things are make a little more sense.
I agree, actually. I think it looks, things like seem to go smoother. I don't know. They seem to charge like more consistently on a certain day and pay you on a certain day, which is nice.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And you can see, like, I had one patron who, I don't know, she was having problems with her card, but it was clearly, like, you know, I scoped out that, you know, her card wasn't going through, and let her know about it, and she said, yeah, I've been having trouble with my card, I'll bow out and then come back when I get it fixed, so.
Mm. Yeah.
Are you guys hearing noise? I don't know where it's coming from.
I was running my scanner a while back, but it's done now. I do hear, like, it sounds like wind or something, or like...
Like some
I
sort
do kind of hear some rustling, but
feedback. Not are feedback, but
feedback? Oh, okay.
Well, it just sounds like noise.
Yeah, I hear it, but I don't know. It's not that bad, is it? I mean,
it's like it just sounds like ambient noise. It doesn't sound too bad to me, but
maybe it's my new headphones. I hear it pretty well.
It's like picking up everything, man.
I don't hear anything. Maybe it's coming from me.
Yeah, I don't know. Jay's bad. So it's not coming from him. So I don't know. Could be coming from him.
How do you mute your thing?
You click on it.
There's a little microphone. You click on the little microphone. It should go red.
It's up at the top of the hangout.
Oh, I see it. All right, I'm going to do it. Tell me if it's me. I got a fan running upstairs. That might be it.
Right now, I don't hear it.
Yeah, it might have been it, but at least for me, it wasn't too bad. But
yeah, I was barely noticing it. I mean,
it's nothing compared to that tornado that Peter was casting off there. For
I don't know what you're talking about.
I wouldn't worry about it, dude. It's not even...
Not bugging me. Don't worry about it.
Yeah.
It's just bugging me. It's okay.
It's payback for making our ears bleed.
Really sensitive headphones are picking that. Maybe that's why. Maybe you're the only one using headphones. Maybe it's louder in headphones.
Yeah, I got
maybe. Oh, do you? Okay.
I think I live closer to Brody. That's why I hear it better.
The EJB says it sounds like a bubbling cauldron.
There you go. It's what I was going to say.
Looks like Tim Phillips was talking about 3D prints, too, that I don't have much of experience with. Because there was a booth. Yeah, 3D prints.
I've never even heard of that.
You mean like 3D printing or prints that are in 3D that you like wear glasses? Because that's actually what I'm working on right now.
I think he's talking about little figures, but that's pretty cool, 3D prints. I'm into that. So there was a booth which was a local company that had these awesome 3D printed figures of their stuff. They looked just like them. They weren't expensive, like $25. And he says, I really want to get into 3D printing. I got into 3D modeling, but it's very difficult. But when you manage to make something good, it's rewarding. And he said, I'd much rather have a 3D figure of a character than a digital print.
So. Yeah, I'd love to have like 3D, you know, printed like stuff, like toys and things, but I can't really, I'm not like a 3D artist, so I'd have to have somebody else design it for me and everything.
Yeah.
And I just don't know how much you can get the cost down on something like that or not, but I'll look into it and probably only get cheaper eventually, so.
Oh, definitely, yeah. It's so new right now.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think it is already kind of coming down, because I remember when I first heard about it, I was all like, cool, you can make some toys, but yeah, it was pretty pricey to get anything done that was, you know, any kind of significant size, but I don't know, you know, after finding, like, Mike and the way he makes, like, his toys and, you know, it's like, I almost think that's the way to go. He can, like, pull copies out of, like, a little silicone mold for, like, nothing, you know?
Really?
Yeah, I mean, you know, but you gotta have the skills like him to do it where, you know. Yeah, I think, you know, I was kind of, like, thinking about trying, like, you know, something on that 3D, but it's just, like, to learn that, you know, like, sculpting in 3D, it's, like, hard. I don't know. Too much to do. Figure out another thing, you know. Somebody said, let's see. all kinds of people have those 3D printers in their homes now.
Yeah, I've seen that. A lot of Kickstarters where people, you know, they send you the parts to build one yourself and all that. It's pretty wild.
Here we go. Shit.
It's like the Star Trek replicators. It's common, man. It's gonna be the 3D printers. We already got the what's it called communicators. So.
You mean phones?
Yep. It's all phones, man. Well, probably like iPhones are like probably, you know, more sophisticated than like the tricorders they were using. Who knows?
I wonder if they used AT&T.
But I've heard like some crazy shit with those like 3D printers. Like they're trying to get them so they can print, parts, like people parts. Like if you lose your ear, they can print you a new ear out of like skin and stuff. That's pretty nuts.
You just need that. You need like a skin cartridge. You just stick the skin cartridge. And you're building cartridge.
I just happen to have one.
Yeah. Yep. Everybody will be bitching about how expensive the skin cartridge is.
Use synthetic skin. It's cheaper.
Yeah. Tim Phillips says, I think Sideshow Collectibles does their stuff in 3D. I don't know if that's true, dude, because it's like, you know, just knowing Mike, he knows a lot of the guys who, like, sculpt for them. And a lot of those guys sculpt by hand, like, in clay and stuff. So unless they're, like, scanning them in later, I'm pretty sure that stuff's getting, like, mass-produced out of molds.
Yeah, I think, I don't know his first name, but Cipriano. Cipriano Sculpture, I think he did a bunch of stuff for Sideshow.
Yeah, does he do 3D sculpting, or is he doing it, like, old school?
A lot
of those guys are really famous, and a lot of them are, you know, like old school, which I think is really cool. And then Demerson says, in China, they 3D print full-size houses. Is that true?
somebody might have done one house. I don't know. I'm not sure if it's mass-produced yet.
Yeah.
There's this YouTube channel I follow called X Robots. Have you heard of this?
Mm-mm.
It's pretty awesome, man. He makes all these robots and props and things, and like this guy must be like a genius or something. Because I mean, he's building like the BB-8 robot from Star Wars.
Wow.
Yeah, it's really cool. Like half the stuff I don't even understand, but some of it you can understand, but he prints most of his parts and stuff 3D and builds these robots. But I was surprised the way he built this robot, because I was kind of wondering how it works, but he's got like the big ball, and then the little head part just kind of rests on top of it, and it's got wheels, and the wheels move in different directions, so it always stays on top, and it pushes the ball along. Like the wheels just push the ball along, but you could go up and pick the head of that robot off and just lift it up because it's not connected. It just sits on top and rolls around.
It's wow.
Pretty. Yeah, I would. Yeah, it's called X Robots. It's on YouTube. I mean, this if you ever want to just see some cool stuff. I mean, this guy, he built this alien costume that he built out of, you know, like Alien from the movie Alien that he built. You know, he printed most of the parts out and. He's got like Iron Man costumes and the arc reactors and all that kind of stuff. I mean, it's
wow.
He does really cool stuff.
Well, I love robots. So.
Yeah, it's really cool. Like I said, I mean, this guy's like, I mean, the stuff he's talking about. I had to change the programming code on the wheel because it was doing this and that. And like, I have no idea what you're talking about, dude, but it's cool.
That's awesome. I follow some guys, like the cosplay guys on YouTube. I actually love, like, you know, how they're making the costumes. I mean, they're getting so crazy with that stuff, man. It sounds like that's like a whole new level, what you're talking about. I'll have to check that station out. And then Themerson says, X-Robots is awesome. He's like a modern-day Tony Stark.
Yeah, he really
is. Superkiller says, it's funny on the screen. It looks like Jeff's drawing is shooting at Brody's drawing.
Yeah, that's been fixing off. Just shoot off.
Then X-Robots is building a full-size Hulkbuster armor, too? Oh, that's crazy.
Oh, yeah. I mean, it's just stuff he builds. It's crazy.
That's so awesome.
Are you ready for your con, Scott?
No, I got a little catching up to do. I'm not worried, but like this weekend out here, it was just it was like beautiful. I mean, we don't get weather like this in May usually, but it was like, you know, it was like cool breeze around 75, and so I took advantage of it and we hung out like and did stuff outside and stuff. But so I got a little catching up to do, but. Yeah, it even snowed up in Flagstaff.
Oh yeah, we got a bunch of snow here too, up in the mountains.
So yeah, it was yeah. I wish it would continue on like that because yeah, it's gonna get hot now. But that was nice little break there for a little bit.
Yeah.
But yeah, so I gotta because I was gonna work a lot this weekend and I just decided not to. So.
Yeah. Well, that's cool.
You need a break.
Yeah, it was nice. Yeah.
There's a con that I want to do in June. It's like the 19th through the 21st, but it's in Charlotte, North Carolina.
Yeah.
And it's like a 5-hour drive, which isn't bad. I mean, I don't mind the drive, but it's I'm just trying to, like, it's hard to find people to do the show with. Like, it would be easier for me if I had somebody to, like, share, like, a hotel room cost with. Because, like, the tables are, like, $300. And then the hotels close to the convention center were, like, $229 a night.
Yeah.
And, like, my idea was that I was just going to drive down the first day of the show, leave really, really early, drive straight to the con, exhibit, check in that night and then only pay for two nights, but I doubt that would be realistic. Probably I'd probably be freaking exhausted.
Can you, like, if you're driving, can you just find some, you know, cheaper hotels like further out? I mean, that's usually what I do if I have like any access to like a car or something. I'll just like go.
Yeah, I haven't looked into it too much to see like how many, like the one that's closest to the place, the convention center, sold out. So I looked at the next one, and it's like $229 a night. I don't know if that's their typical rate or if it's just upped because of, you know, the event going on. The one at the convention center that across the street, they actually had a con rate on people, like grouped out, but they're all sold out.
Yeah.
But that's, you know, it would be nice if I lived in a city or something where other artists were planning on going to that show. But, like, where I'm from, it's like nobody does.
Where exactly are you?
Shenandoah County, Virginia. So, like, in the middle of the country. Surrounded by a bunch of woods and cows.
Yeah. Well, I'm not too far from you. I mean, I'm not planning to do anything serious this year, but we could talk for next year.
All right. It would be a lot easier.
There you go. There's some racket.
I've taken down my little camera setup.
That's pretty cool. That's looking up, Scott. I guess I haven't looked up yet.
What's that?
That's pretty cool, that piece you're working on. Little
yeah.
Motorcycle guy on some kind of speed bike or something.
Yeah, I'm going to do a... Hold on. Excuse the sound. I'm trying to set my mic up. All right. I'm going to...
do like a, I'm going to try to do like a 3D print, like I was saying, where you, and get some glasses, because I found you can get like a, I don't know, like 100 glasses or something online for like under $20 or whatever. So I'm going to order just the cheap paper red and blue glasses, and I'm going to try to make just this scene where this girl's on this space bike and there's, you know, ships coming after her, and try to make it like 3D and everything. So
awesome.
We'll see. How do you go about doing that? Like, is there something special you have to do?
I'm not positive yet. When I was a kid, I used to do it. I would get like, they had like those little lapens. They had a blue one that worked and then a red one. And I would just draw, I'd like make stencils. Like I made like these asteroids and I'd kind of draw the stencils and then I'd trace the same thing. And I forgot which one, but you put one color in front, one in back. You know, depending if you want it to go in the distance or you want it to come forward. And it's just duplicating those two images. And then your eyes, once you put the glasses on, they bring them together. So I know it can be done. There's tutorials online on how to do it too. So I'm going to worry about that later. But it'd be so much easier now with computers that I can just draw the one picture and then duplicate it and change the color. Whereas before I had to, you know, I had to actually redraw everything.
Yeah.
It's pretty cool.
I kind of remember that, actually, like when we were kids. Something like that. It was like a... Did you learn that out of a book, or was that something you bought, like a little pad with the pens and stuff?
I just one day, because, you know, back then we didn't have the internet. There might have been other kids doing it, but I just said, because I had 3D comics. I'm looking how they're done. I'm like, oh, it's the same picture, just repeated. And I'm like, I wonder if I tried to draw if it would work, and it did. So
it's like back engineered by looking at the comics. That's super cool. Yeah, that's something I haven't seen much of, like 3D prints, at least, at cons.
Yeah, I don't know. It's a weird thing, because part of it, I think there's a cool kind of novelty to it, but I want to try to make it cool, so because most people, if you're hanging a poster on the wall, most people are going to have glasses to look at it, but I want it, it's going to be worked into, like, the whole theme of it. Like, it'll say something like escape from the third dimension or something, so it'll kind of work even if you don't have the glasses. Like, oh, it's like, it's just, you're looking at it saying, oh, it's like an old 3D type thing that's kind of cool just as a poster by itself, but then it would actually work in 3D too, so I don't
really
know.
If I was going to be a customer and I was going to buy something like that, then I would just, whenever I put the thing up in my house, I would just put the glasses there with it to, like, guests or, you know, people.
Yeah. Well, that's what I would do too, yeah, so we'll see, you know, it's just
a good idea. Worth exploring, you know.
Should do glowing the dock posters.
You know what? That's kind of a cool idea. I wonder. There's got to be places out there that can do that. I have to Google that.
Yeah,
I try to do glow in the dark sketch cards. I bought some black paper and I tried to buy these glow in the dark pens, and it did not work. they're not opaque enough to, you know, to work.
Yeah.
Yeah.
The chat is quiet.
Quiet.
It's my
quiet night. Everyone.
Yeah, I don't know. I pretty much got all my prints made finally, so.
That's cool.
All I gotta do is just get myself there now.
So how many, it's a 3-day show? Do they have like a preview night or anything there?
Just Friday. Yeah. It's not preview night, though.
Yeah, I really do want to go next year, so I'm trying to figure out how to do it, because, like, the friends that I could stay with over there, they're actually friends of my girlfriend, but my girlfriend might not be able to go. Like, I'm thinking, what? Because I just don't know if she can get that much time off work, so maybe she'll...
Yeah.
See, I wonder if I drove down there, she flies in, and we can both ride back together, if that would make sense. But I've never, like, drove anywhere like that by myself. I'm afraid I get lost. But, sometimes you just got to figure it out. But, I mean, nowadays you've got navigation and everything like that, so...
Yeah. Denver's not that big. I mean, it's like a big city, but not, like compared to like Chicago or something. It's pretty small.
Yeah. I'm just thinking just getting there, like, I guess it's not that difficult, but...
No, not from out Arizona.
Yeah.
Just go to New Mexico and turn north.
You'll hit it. I'm afraid, like, I'm going to miss the turn or something. Like, right. They made that nothing Kentucky. Like most of them.
Yeah,
I gotta get over that. Cause once I figure it out,
cool. I'm gonna make it out next year.
That'd be awesome.
Yeah.
I don't know. There's not really any room in my house, but you guys can stay at my dad's house.
I got a place to stay. I mean, there's like I said, I've met them before, cool and everything. So they, even if my girlfriend doesn't go. And she's got family out there, too, which I've also met. So. There's no shortage of places to stay there. It's just, I wish I knew some people in Seattle, because that show's supposed to be pretty good. Although it got bought out, so I don't know. I'll see if it still is good.
Yeah, I wonder if, like, that's an easy show to get a table at, because everybody talks about it so much.
I don't think it is, but, if I got on the waiting list, I think Seattle's probably all booked up,
Yeah, the only other cons I've kind of thought maybe about going is, like, there's a con, like the Spectrum Con and Illex Con, which is kind of more illustrators.
Yeah, they talk about that on, like, the Fantastic Week.
But that's in, I think they're both, like, Kansas City Spectrum Con, and then Illex Con's, like, east of that, but that wouldn't be that hard to get to. Kansas City, that's not that far from me. It's a ways, but...
Yeah, for you, I think that would work. I don't know if that would work so much for me. I'm trying to... I wish there were, like, more sci-fi cons, because my stuff's got a lot of sci-fi,
Yeah.
So, but I don't know too many of them, There's horror cons out here, but they're,
Really?
I don't know. We don't really have too many sci-fi cons. I guess the comic cons are just considered sci-fi cons.
Well, they have, like, one here, but it's, like, a really small show. It's kind of like the old shows. But it's like, Doctor Who and Star Trek, centric. But I've been up to that one. They have, like, sci-fi stuff. Your stuff would probably do well there. But it's just, like I said, just a really small show. I don't know if they have big shows like that.
There's the scary manga shows.
Yeah, I'm curious if I would do okay at those. Cause, I mean, my stuff definitely isn't manga, but it is kind of, it's a little more cute than, I don't know. I wonder.
I only went to one. Like, I wasn't part of it. Even forget, it might have been the Virginia convention. I forget where it was. But it was a regular comic convention at the same time that they were doing an anime convention. And the anime convention was in, like, a different part of the hotel or wherever it was. And it was a much smaller room. But it was, like, packed wall to wall with stuff, and I don't know, it's like that one specifically was more merchandise, so there were artists there. They were, like, scattered in between things, but I assume, you could probably do pretty decently an anime convention
Yeah, it seems, I don't know, I mean, I haven't been to one, but it seems from the videos and stuff that I've watched and everything, it seems that they might be more receptive to, like, independent artists and stuff. I don't know. I mean, a lot of people there are doing anime fan art, but, like, it seems more like little, I don't know that they go there to see, well, maybe voice actors and stuff like that, but, you know, because it's anime, it's not, it's, there's no, like, actual, like, actors, like, live, like, in-person people, I guess, to see, so I think it's more they're going to see artists, I would guess.
Yeah.
I could be wrong. I mean, that might be totally a phase, but...
Well, I definitely want to hit one myself. Like, I think they have big ones in Florida. You know, I mean, I'll do specific stuff for the convention, for like an anime convention, but I'll have my other stuff as well. Just to give it a shot. Yeah. Like, I like the, you know, the culture and the scene.
I know that they have an anime con in Denver. It's like, whenever I see that thing, I think I'm going to try to just go, not chill at it, but just go just to see if there's any chance, you know?
Right.
That I might fit in there. But yeah, I have no idea. I've never been to one. I did actually, I snuck onto that one site, called like PixIv or something like that. You seen it, Peter?
Right, yeah.
And it's all like anime stuff, yeah.
Yeah, it's in, you know, it's not English.
No, it's like, yeah, it's all like, I don't know, Chinese, Japanese, I'm not sure what it is. But I hope, you know, I went ahead and signed up and put some of my art on there. See if I can get kicked out.
And they all go, who's that white boy?
That's right. Oh, well. Been looking for like new places to post stuff, so I thought, what the heck, I'll try this.
It's good to explore, you know, just like show up. People wouldn't think they would find you or whatever.
Gotta find the next thing, I guess. I just noticed, you know, like, speaking of that, like, I posted that new Frankenstein piece on Facebook, and I got, like, a lot of comments on Twitter. And, thanks, man. And I posted it on DeviantArt, and I was kind of amazed, because I got so many comments on Facebook. I only got 3 comments on DeviantArt for that piece. I'm just like, I just think the DeviantArt is just dying, man.
Nah.
Like, interaction is just down, dude, though. Like, I used to get, like, 50 comments on that site.
Well, you know, it used to be, like, you know, Facebook used to be and Twitter used to be really easy just to post something and get instantaneous traffic and comments and, you know, I think it's still a worthwhile site. I mean, I love the site. It's changing in ways I probably wouldn't go, but I still think it will be relevant over the long run.
Well, I'm not going to leave it, but it's like, I don't know that it's going. I think it is actually kind of taking a downturn. Like, I noticed, too, like, they seem to be pushing the ads on that site even more than I've ever seen it. Like, I don't have, like, the account you buy. And, like, I noticed, like, now when I go to the site, they actually hit me with, like, this full-page ad that I have to click buy to get into DeviantArt. And I'm just like, man, that's pretty aggressive. Yeah.
If you think it's going away, what do you think's replacing it?
I don't know.
The paid version?
Instagram, I don't know. You mean like as far as like an art site that's like as good as that?
Yeah, I guess. I'm just usually if something kind of starts to fade away, it's because it's being replaced by something else. And I just don't know anything else like kind of like DeviantArt. But I never really I haven't really done much on DeviantArt. Like the stuff on there right now, I probably need to go back and, you know, it's all like The only thing on there that I have is I don't think I have any original stuff. It's all like stuff I did for game companies and stuff like that. So.
Yeah. I will say that, like, you know, the majority of people that used to comment on DeviantArt actually comment now on Facebook. You know what I mean? That's where I see those people. A lot of them are still commenting, but they're totally on Facebook. They're not on DeviantArt anymore. But I can tell, you know. So maybe it's just, you know, just the natural... I mean, it seems like everybody's migrating to Facebook. Like, a lot of the forums I used to go to that are just, like, towns now... You know, those guys were, like, on Facebook, like the Frazetta Forum. That thing, I don't even know if that thing's even up anymore. All those guys were on, like, the Facebook, you know, Frazetta Roundtable now. Every one of them that I used to see on there is in there now. So.
So I'm looking it up. I don't know if I... clicked on the right thing. Let's see. Behance, yeah, we heard of them.
Yeah, I'm on Behance.
Audison.com? Haven't heard of that one.
Yeah, I haven't heard of that one.
You guys Tumblr, on ArtStation?
I'm on ArtStation.
I heard of ArtStation.
Yeah. Are you on that one, Jeff?
No, I'm not. I've been looking at it, and I'm still kind of deciding if it's even worthwhile.
I haven't got any interaction there, but it's like I get like a lot of likes and that kind of stuff.
Yeah.
But nobody's really, you know, I've gotten a couple comments, but there's been like some other artists that I follow have followed me back there. So it kind of makes me think that maybe that's going to be something eventually. Yeah. You know? But I wonder, it's like, that site seems to have, like, it's weird. I mean, it's got, like, the public site, and then they have, it, like, gives you, like, your own, sort of, like, what they're calling your own website. So I wonder if they're, like, just getting us all in there to, like, hit us with some pay thing eventually.
Yeah, like, I've looked at it more than a few times, and, I mean, like, the layout's nice, but...
Yeah.
I don't know, even kind of the navigation of it, I'm not a big fan of. Like, when you get to whoever's page, it looks good, but it doesn't even seem like there's a lot of room to interact with people on it, if you know what I'm saying.
Yeah. Well, yeah, it'd just be commenting back and forth would be the only thing. Like, on people's art, you know. But I don't know. To me, it's just like, I mean, I'm on all those freaking sites. Like, that Infected by site, I'm on that one. It's just, to me, it's just, you know, I'm just driving traffic to eBay auctions by being on there, you know. So, it yeah. doesn't really matter to me if it's like, you know, it's just part of my, you know, roster of, like, where I post. I post on Tumblr and all that shit just to catch whoever's going to go through there. Behance is the same way though. Like I get like so, like just tons of likes and stuff, but I rarely get a comment off of there.
Yeah. Well, do you think that's just because it is, you know, like an artist site? Like you're just generally dealing with other artists?
Probably.
Yeah, I kind of think that's the one problem with all these sites. You know, ArtStation, DeviantArt, like whatever. It's all bait. I'd imagine probably like a good 80-90% of the people on the sites are artists themselves. Like you're not really driving to a public market with it.
Yeah. I was just gonna say,
you know, like DeviantArt is where I got my most gigs, you know, commissions and whatnot. So. You know, I won't give it up for that reason.
Like, how many commissions are you talking? Like, 10 or 200?
Between that? I don't know. Like,
no, because I'm saying, you know, other artists are always going to buy other artists' work. That goes hand in hand. But, you know, if you're saying you get commissions, and yeah, I got 20 commissions over 2 years, like, to me, that's not a lot.
Yeah.
Well, I never really... pushed hard on, you know, getting commissions because I'm still more to do. But I've probably done like 40 or 50.
In what kind of time span?
Well, in the time I've been there.
Which is what, like 5 years? Like,
I've been there, yeah, probably a long time. But, I mean, more than anywhere else, I mean, you know, I probably could have upped that by a good amount, you know, if I really pushed it every day.
Well, I'm just totally curious on this. Like, on DeviantArt, how would you push that every day? Like,
well, I mean, not every day, but, like, if I just posted even once a week that I'm open for commissions. Like, I never got into that kind of rhythm.
Well, I don't know. Like, I just kind of assume, like, you look at any artist, I assume that they're always open for commissions unless they boldly say otherwise.
Well, I noticed that, you know, for every 9 commissions I got, it was because I posted about it. You know. I might get a random one here and there. Just, hey, do you do commissions? But it's specifically people ask me for a commission because I posted about it or I showed off an old commission, you know, a new commission I finished off or something.
Right.
Well, I know, like, back, you know, in the day when, like, you know, sketch cards, or maybe just because I was doing sketch cards, I'm not doing them anymore, but, like, DeviantArt was, like, awesome for, like, sketch cards, you know, commissions, and all the collectors just hung out on DeviantArt, and I think it's because they could, like, you know, save different people's work, and, you know, it's got that, you know, feature where you, like, favorite it or whatever, and then it shows up in your little collection on your DeviantArt page. And so, like, you know, like, I think, you know, whatever, you know, 4 or 5 years ago, it was definitely worth being on there just because of the sketch card guys. But I don't know if that's changed or it's like I've just changed, you know. Maybe I'm just moving into a different market because some sketch card guys don't buy bigger art. They're just into sketch cards, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
To me, it just sounds like it's not as relevant as it once was.
Well, that's what I'm saying. I don't know, you know. It just seems
seems with all the art sites, like conceptart.org, that was like really popular. And it went downhill. CG Hub, that was
died, man.
CG Hub was huge. Like a lot of artists even use that just to put their portfolios up for like jobs, and that shut down like totally unexpectedly. They patented the name so nobody could open another CG Hub. Like they just closed it and it can't be reopened. And then that's when like that one that you guys were mentioning that you, like when we started this conversation, like that popped up right after CG Hub shut down, like a lot of those new sites to try to kind of fill the gap.
You mean that ArtStation was?
Yeah, ArtStation. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Well, that makes that's why there's right okay.
Shut down.
Yeah, that's probably why there's like bigger guys because that's what I noticed about that ArtStation. Why I kind of thought, okay, maybe I'll get on this is because there I saw like. Like, you know, it's not just a bunch of, like, little, you know, like, famous artists are on there all of a sudden. And I'm kind of like, well, you know, maybe I should do this, so. But that makes more sense.
Yeah. It just seems like everything's going, like, it starts off awesome, and then it just changes course, and it goes downhill over time. And is that what we're going to look at for everything that we use?
Well, I think half of this, too, is because the technology's changed so drastically. Like, nowadays, you know, I know a lot of people that don't even have a computer. They're either just using a tablet or their iPhones and stuff. And now, you know, like, with social media, like Facebook and Instagram, like, there's an app for it. All you got to do is hit the button, boom, it's on your screen, 2 seconds. And no matter where you are, you can be at your desk, at the gym, on the train, you can pull it up, make a comment. Like, I think the technology has a huge bearing on it. Like, I mean, if... I don't know, maybe ArtStation came out with an interactive app that might help them.
Mm-hmm.
But everybody has Facebook or everybody has Twitter or, you know.
Yeah, and they're all self-friendly, you know, like, and that's...
Yeah.
That's half the problem. Like, not many people are sitting down during the day with a PC in front of them.
Yeah, unless they're trapped at work and they can get on the internet.
Yeah. But I mean, even then, you know, most offices, you know, some allow it, and a lot of them disallow it. Like they don't want people on that shit anymore. Like, they're making a big deal out of it nowadays because people, the productivity has gone down so much in offices.
Yeah. I do think the phone thing is, like, taking over, and that's why, like, you're seeing sites like Instagram just killing it.
Yeah.
Because it's, like, everybody on their phone.
With the exception of a few people.
Yeah. I mean, they can block the internet at work, but they're not going to take your cell phone away from you.
Yeah, Scott, you need to get a cell phone, dude.
Yeah, really.
I worked at a place where they, I mean, it was bad. They wouldn't let you use your cell phone or anything, or yeah. And it was this was actually, you know, an artist job. It was like I got out of there.
Really?
Yeah, it was really bad. I think I've probably talked about it before, but I went from working at this game company where, you know, you go sit there and watch movies while you're working and all this stuff to this other company that basically you clock in and they do everything but strap like an iron like ball to your leg so you can't move and you have to ask permission to use the restroom and stuff. It was bad.
Oh, Lordy.
Yeah, it was horrible. But like with DeviantArt, I never really I had some stuff on there, but I mostly just used it to look for inspiration and stuff because there was a lot of cool artwork up there. But now I use Pinterest for that because it seems way more searchable and I can, you know, collect references and stuff like that. So
yeah.
I don't know if it's, you know, not everyone used DeviantArt the same as I did, but that could be part of it, you know. Just there might not be one thing, it might be a bunch of little other things that might be driving people away from it.
Well, Yeah, that is true, and I use DeviantArt like that still. Like, I just like to browse and find other artists and then also, like, photo reference and stuff on there, you know, because there's a lot of photographers and stuff, so.
But as far as, like, events, I don't really think, you know, as far as a social network, I don't know how well it, you know, I don't. All I know is that I like the layout, and there is some really cool stuff, and it seems way more professional, at least what I've looked at, than a bunch of, you know, DeviantArt, you got to weed through a lot of garbage before you find good stuff.
Yeah. Oh,
God, yeah.
I think I got on Behance because, like, somewhere on some podcast, there was a lady talking about how great, you know, how much work she was getting off of Behance. So I thought, well, I better be on there. But I never have gotten any kind of jobs or anything from there. But, yeah, I agree. It seems a hell of a lot more professional, like DeviantArt, you know. I mean, just the name, you know. Don't have to explain to somebody what it is. No, it's not.
Yeah, it sounds like it's some kind of adult line or something.
Yeah.
Thanks, Jesse, in the chat. He says, you guys are all working on some kick-ass pieces.
Oh, cool.
Thank you.
Yeah. So Tim says he tries to discourage smartphone use in high schools. But they're so addicted they can't stop.
Yeah.
I agree. Get them off their phones, dude.
Keep them away from the technique.
Yeah. School's a different thing. Like, I'm surprised, like, because, like, I have a question for, like, one of my kids, and I'll send them a text, and they'll, like, respond. And I'm thinking, I just sent it because when they do get in between class or something and they can get back to me. But it seems like they get back to me sometimes pretty quick, so I don't know.
Yeah.
It's because they love you. They want to, you know, answer you right away.
I'm amazed they actually let kids like carry their cell phones like during class and stuff. You'd think that would be totally.
I don't know about that.
That's weird. Tim Phillips must be like a high school teacher or something.
I remember I was at a friend's house and his kid had like one of those handheld game players and whatever, and he'd take that into the bathroom and be in there for like an hour and a half, sitting on the toilet playing a video game. I was like, really?
You sure that's all he was doing?
Yeah, that's all he was doing. But it just like, you know, really? You know. It just seems really strange, but I'm sure it just feels natural to him.
Yeah. Well, I don't know. I mean, you know, my nephew's got a cell phone, and that's how he is. He's always freaking looking at this or that, you know, while he's talking to you and losing his train of thought.
Yeah, you think technology was going to make us better, but...
Right. Turn this into zombies.
Some people in the same room just text each other instead of communicating.
Or not. You ever do that, Scott? Like, text your kids, like, in the living room so they'll answer you?
a couple of times I've done that, like if I'm downstairs and they're upstairs. Like, I don't do it that much, but it would probably be helpful, like, because, you know, I used to yell up and stuff. The house I lived in, we had, like, this intercom system, and then my parents would just push a button, and then you'd be upstairs and be like, get down here. And sometimes that's I wish I had that here, but yeah, so it used to be bad because I got that little play area, but they haven't been in there as much lately, but it's like that little room I have.
Yeah.
Kind of, you can't, if you're in there, you can't hear somebody else, so like I might text, but I usually just send one of my other kids up there to go get them.
Send in the mall.
Yeah.
Go break it up. So yeah, Timothy Phillips says constant blue light dopamine. Talking about cell phone line. And then Jesse says, you guys think the crowd on DeviantArt might be part of the issue. It's full of kids drawing anime and trying to get into character concept art. Not that there's anything wrong with that. And then Tim Phillips says the DA crowd is a major factor. I agree. And there is. There's definitely that anime manga thing going on at DeviantArt. I've definitely seen it.
Yeah.
I don't know.
You know, everything changes, even the best of things, especially the best of things. You know, for a while there, I was ready to totally give it up because it seemed like, you know, they brought in those motion comics, which, you know, for the most part, they're not for me. But it really took the focus, and then... people were able to post videos on their deviations, and it just seems like there's nobody posting regular art anymore. But, you know, I got over that, and it sort of changed on itself. I don't know. You know, it's not like I'm really seeking out a lot of people there. I do occasionally browse, and I do, anytime I'm looking for reference, I do go to DeviantArt, even though, you know, Pinterest has a larger spectrum of stuff, but I still use DeviantArt.
I gotta try, like, Pinterest a little bit more for, like, photo reference. I wonder if I could find some good stuff on there, because I never think to go there.
Yeah, I think it's a great site for that, for reference, because you definitely find a lot of stuff you would never find in any other search.
Yeah, that's pretty neat. I like it when I go there and look around, so. My son's actually out there fighting bad guys in the hallway again, so.
Saving the world.
You hear that. It's all into Ultron now. I don't know if he knows he's a bad guy, though. Like, he just likes his Iron, you know, because he looks kind of like Iron Man.
Maybe.
The other day, he came running out to me, and, like, I was washing dishes, and he's just like, Dad. And I'm like, what? And he's like, the Hulk, he just wants to be left alone. Yeah.
He's very astute.
Yeah.
It is true.
Yeah. It was like, you're right.
Always people trying to, you know, shoot the Hulk down, otherwise he'd just be sitting there.
Yeah.
Well, anyway, let's go ahead and just wrap up the show today. If anybody's got something else they want to throw in before we go. Alrighty. So, Brody, what's your website?
BrodyWilliams.com and BrodyWilliams on Facebook.
Cool. And Jay, what's yours?
AirheadsCustom.com, Airheads with a Z.
Cool. That piece looks great, too, man.
Thank you.
And Peter, what's your website?
It's or human.
Wherever you're at.
I'm at everywhere. But you can find my website at humanartstudio.com.
Cool. And Scott?
Scott Cirklin. I'm at cirkworks.com and cirkworks on YouTube. And if you happen to be in Phoenix, Arizona on Friday the 29th through the 31st, I'll be at booth 6037.
Nice.
Come and see me.
Yeah. Go by and get some cool 3D prints.
Yeah. And... I'm glad to have this done by then, so.
Nice. And I'm Jeff Lafferty, jefflafferty.net. I wanted to mention a Frankenstein piece. I made it a print, and it's in my Etsy store. And also on my website, there's a coupon code for 20% off of my prints if you guys are interested. And we'll see you tomorrow.
See ya.